trip to the past. As I was thinking about today's topic, I thought about the period of the early 1990s when Ukraine, from being actually virtually non-existent on the mental map of most of the world, suddenly found itself as the third largest nuclear power on the planet, or at least the possessor of the third largest arsenal of nuclear weapons. And I suppose the difference between the two will be part of a discussion today. It was a status that continued for a few short years, but its repercussions, I think, for Ukraine, for the region, and for the globe, I suppose, reverberate to this day. So it's a very interesting topic that we will listen to today, interpreting the bomb, ownership, and deterrence in Ukraine's nuclear discourse. There's no one that I can think of better suited to explain it all to us than Mariana Budjeryn, who not only has done a dissertation on the subject of Ukraine's nuclear disarmament, but also has studied it very extensively and researches to this day questions of nuclear proliferation and non-proliferation worldwide. So she will be able to put the Ukrainian issue in the much broader context of one of the major preoccupations, I think, of people dealing with security worldwide. Mariana Budjeryn comes to us originally from Ukraine, but via Hungary, via Budapest. She graduated from the National University of Kiev Mohyla Academy in Kiev, and then did her master's and PhD work at the Central European University in Budapest, the institution that has more recently come under fire as being the incubator of wrong ideas. We're glad that she was able to accomplish her work before any further problems developed there. As I mentioned, her dissertation was, I'll give you the exact title, The Power of the NPT, International Norms and Nuclear Disarmament of Belarus, Kazakhstan, and Ukraine, 1990 to 1994. Since completing her dissertation, she has been a research fellow, specifically Stanton Nuclear Security Fellow, for a couple of years at the Kennedy School of Government, the Belfer Center, and followed that up by her present position as a postdoctoral fellow at the Data Center for Russian and Eurasian Studies. She has published quite a number of articles dealing with these various issues. Just to mention a few of the more recent ones, the nuclear fallout of Trump's possible detente with Putin. Was Ukraine's nuclear disarmament a blunder? The North Korean missile engines, not from Ukraine, to put it in that global context. And, you know, for me, especially interesting non-nuclear issues, against all odds, Konstantin Morozov and the unlikely establishment of Ukrainian military. Konstantin Morozov was Ukraine's first minister of defense, and following his resignation from that position, he was a research fellow at the Ukrainian Research Institute here at Harvard. So it's, you know, comes close to home. So I'm very pleased to present to you Mariana Budjeryn, and I think you all hear something very interesting and significant. Please.
Thank you so much for your kind introduction, Professor Haida. And without further ado, we shall jump right into this topic. Some of you perhaps might have attended last week the presentation I did at the Davis Center. Last Tuesday, I presented kind of in a more, you know, a broader topic closely related to my dissertation now than my current book project. This particular presentation, this talk, is more specifically catered to Ukraine, of course, being this the Ukrainian studies seminar in Ukrainian studies. So as Professor Hayda briefly mentioned, Ukraine sort of suddenly found itself as a host or an owner of world's largest, third largest nuclear arsenal. Not only was it world's third largest, it was summarily larger than the other three nuclear possessors combined. So the sort of fourth, fifth, and sixth, so China, UK, and France combined. And that, of course, happened as a result of the collapse of a nuclear superpower, the Soviet Union. This became, for a very short time, a very hot international issue, both in the United States and Russia and worldwide. And as Professor Hayda mentioned, in a few short years, by 1994, Ukraine has renounced nuclear weapons, has joined the international non-proliferation regime as a non-nuclear weapons state. It's a big international treaty. Signed in 1968, whereby only five nuclear powers are recognized, the Soviet Union and then Russia, US, France, China, and the UK. All other parties must join this treaty as non-nuclear weapon states, renouncing their sovereign right to develop or otherwise acquire nuclear weapons. So Ukraine had joined that. In 1994, on November 16th, I believe, so it's coming up on the on an anniversary. In July 1996, the last nuclear warhead had left Ukraine's territory. And then with U.S. technical assistance, all of the missiles were taken out of their silos, dismantled the silos themselves, you know, these in-ground silos, I'll have some photos for you later on. Were demolished, and with that, Ukraine had no vestiges of anything nuclear on its territory. Here you see the picture of the 43rd rocket or missile army, one of the five missile armies of the Soviet Union that was headquartered in Vinnytsia. And by the time Ukraine became independent, as you can see, the sort of extraterritorially the lines of command, the chains of command crisscrossed borders. So it commanded under Soviet time two divisions in Belarus, Lida and Postave, and one in Orjinkidze in Russia. But by the time 1991 rolled along, we're really talking about two divisions, one in Pervomaisk and one in Khmelnytsky, that had under their command intercontinental ballistic missiles, and a lot of them. So the question then is, why was it that Ukraine decided to forgo this inheritance? Right? We see headlines all the time these days about states wanting nuclear weapons, in particular North Korea, Iran, right? The great powers are making all sorts of efforts to thwart this nuclear acquisition. So the question is, you know, why a country that has such a wealth of nuclear inheritance would give it up? So there's several both existing accounts and theories, and I'll spare you sort of the literature review part, but just to in a nutshell, there are generally recognized things in relation to Ukraine, but also in relation to other nuclear possessors or seekers of nuclear weapons that drive renunciation. For instance, Ukraine, the weapons that were left in Ukraine's territory were operationally subordinated to Moscow, right? So command and control lines, these kilometers of underground cables and wires through which all of the system worked, all kind of converged onto Moscow. So the claim is that Ukraine, that those weren't really Ukraine's weapons to give up because Ukraine never really had operational control over these weapons. There was an immense US and Russian pressure, which is true, to force Ukraine to give up nuclear weapons. there was, whoever remembers early 1990s in Ukraine will know that, you know, the economic situation was quite dire. So to develop or maintain any sort of big armament complexes would have been a challenge, not to mention to withstand, you know, economic sanctions and isolation and things like that that would have followed a nuclear acquisition. And of course, there's the non-proliferation regime, there are international norms where, you know, everyone sort of understands that nuclear weapons are sort of these terrible weapons, and perhaps they should not, you know, exist in the world, and perhaps the less states possess them, the better, right? But there were also significant drivers of, possible drivers of proliferation, particularly in Ukrainian case. Very early on, already in early 1992, Ukrainian political leaders understood that, you know, the threat that's emanating from Moscow was not negligible, and that it could jeopardize the very establishment of this new independent nation. And as opposed to other nuclear aspirants, let's put it this way, there were actual physical nuclear weapons on Ukraine's territory. So it wasn't giving up some kind of hypothetical right to develop in the future nuclear weapons. They were actually there on the territory of Ukraine. They were deployed. They were nuclear warheads on these missiles, right? And as the U.S. has learned the hard way, sometimes not even the most powerful states in the international system can force a very committed proliferator to, you know, to stop their efforts. We can see, we saw that with North Korea. We've seen that later on, you know, after Ukraine's story was over in 1998, with both India and Pakistan, who had announced that they have nuclear deterrence of their own. So none of these kind of tools that U.S. employed and other, you know, powerful states employed against these proliferators seem to have worked. So the aim of my research here and the aim of this talk is to sort of untangle the particulars of Ukraine's nuclear stories to see how these drivers of renunciation, drivers of proliferation had played out in Ukraine's story. And here I talk about supply and demand side of proliferation, and that's kind of proliferation people's talk, and what that actually means for everyone in simple human language is the supply side is really the technology side, right? It's what the country possesses in terms of technology and know-how and capacity to develop nuclear weapons, right? We know that some states, like, for instance, let's not pick on anyone, but Zimbabwe, right, has a limited capacity, you know, technological and scientific capacity to develop a nuclear weapon, whereas somebody like Sweden has a very high technological capacity to develop. So their supply side is quite generous. And the demand side is really the political side, the political motivation, the security and threat perceptions and all of that that go into desiring a nuclear weapon or wanting to keep them, right? So to give you sort of the gist of the argument of this talk up front, it seems that amongst all these other things that were at play in Ukraine's case, there was one very noticeable thing that was missing, and that was the capacity of political leaders to conceive of these weapons in military strategic terms, like we do here in the United States, to conceive of them in terms of a deterrent. And I'll explain exactly what that means. My argument is not, I'll preempt to right away, is not that that somehow determined Ukraine's renunciation. But on the scale of things that were both on the renunciation side and the proliferation side, it helped to tip the scale in favor of renunciation. So when we talk about nuclear weapons, sort of to zoom out to 30,000 feet, for a minute. We talk about not just any kind of weapon. right? It was recognized very early on after the development by the United States in 1945 and after the first and only detonations of nuclear weapons in war by the US military over Japan in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, that this weapon marks a revolutionary shift. And U.S. strategist Bernard Brody was the first, one of the first people to note that. He noted that before, throughout the entire human history, weapons have been developed to win wars. Now, since the advent of nuclear weapons, the purpose of these weapons is to prevent wars. So they're working exactly when they're not used, when they're not being exploded, right? This gave rise to the whole theory of deterrence, and there are so many different reiterations of it in this country, and the whole forest have been felled to create paper in which the deterrence thinking had been expressed in writing. But basically, the main idea of it is somewhat paradoxical, that you must issue a credible threat of nuclear retaliation exactly in order to dissuade your adversary from launching a nuclear attack, right? So you must threaten the very thing that you're trying to avoid. And there's also great literature out there on the paradoxes inherent in this concept of nuclear deterrence. But as people, you know, strategists on this side of the Atlantic and also, you know, in the Soviet Union have been working on it, it is generally understood that there are several things that go into kind of cobbling together a credible deterrent. One is the technological part, right? You need to have hardware that needs to be reliable. There needs to be robust command control and communication within your forces where you can really ensure technologically that when there is an oncoming attack, you can launch a retaliatory strike. There needs to be a determination. There needs to be a sense of resolve and commitment, and leaders must communicate this resolve and must assure their adversary that they mean business, that when worse comes to worse, their finger will not, you know, they will not glitch a bat an eye, and they will press that button. There isn't a button, actually, but they will put in the codes, right? And they need to communicate that to their adversary. They need to let the other side know that this is what they have, both the technology and the resolve. There, of course, are other reasons to aspire nuclear weapons that have been discussed. There's, you know, international prestige. It admits you to a certain kind of big boys club. Although, you know, of course, there are caveats to that. It's it seems that not every state can translate their nuclear armaments into international power. Like, think of Pakistan and North Korea, for instance. And there's, of course, sort of this international clout, international power, being able to coerce, you know, other states into doing, bidding your will without actually threatening a nuclear attack, but just it's always somehow in the background. So how did Ukraine and Ukrainian leaders who really probably never thought of nuclear weapons before early 1990s, interpreted this nuclear capability on their territory? Well, to begin with, Ukraine started its path towards independence with nuclear renunciation, right? On July the 16th, 1990, Ukrainian parliament, the first multi-party parliament democratically elected in March that year, was in its first session and sitting, and it passed this very important document, right, that marked Ukraine's break, the beginning of Ukraine's break from Moscow. And in Article 9, it solemnly proclaimed that it wants to be a neutral state and abide by three nuclear, non-nuclear principles, principles that that is, not to receive, develop, or acquire nuclear weapons. And this language is taken from the NPT, from the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, as to the obligations of the non-nuclear states under the treaty. Why? Why was it? And it was, if you read the transcript of the parliamentary proceedings, of the Verkhovna Rada proceedings, of the, it seems that it was quite sudden. There was a big discussion in the parliament about the including the clause about Ukraine's independent military. And the communists in the parliaments were adamantly against it. And there was a big debacle and there was a big debate. And suddenly, the, one of the leaders of Ukraine's National Democrats, Ivan Drach, pops up to the rostrum and says, and I have a proposition, I have an idea. Why don't we include in the text of the declaration a clause that will proclaim us neutral and non-nuclear in the future? And without much discussion, this clause was included in the final text of the declaration, and the declaration was overwhelmingly passed. So what are the reasons for it? Of course, one very obvious and very important reason was the general anti-nuclear sentiment that was very pervasive in Ukraine as well as in Belarus, for that matter, that resulted from the Chernobyl nuclear power plant disaster. But the other that is less intuitive, perhaps, and less talked about is the reasons provided by Volodymyr Vasilenko, who was the alleged author of this non-nuclear clause. He was a diplomat and also member of RUH, Ukraine's National Democrats. And he said that basically, given these technological ties, given the command and control system through which sort of the Soviet strategic forces operated, Ukraine could not be an independent state if it did not sever these technological ties, if this weaponry was not somehow removed from Ukraine. So nuclear weapons and nuclear weapon systems were viewed at the time as this kind of chain that held Ukraine tied to Moscow. And there was an understanding that only by severing this chain could Ukraine be free and independent. And plus, there was also amongst the diplomats an understanding that there is this big international non-proliferation regime and that Ukraine would probably not be able to be recognized and receive, obtain diplomatic recognition as an independent state if it still had these nuclear weapons on its territory. However, things became quite complicated quickly when the Soviet Union sort of unraveled in August of 1991, probably surprising even Ukraine's National Democrats, who thought that would be kind of a more prolonged, gradual process. But because of the coup of August 19 and the HKCP, the process of Soviet disintegration became quite irreversible. And Ukrainian parliament turned around and passed the Declaration of Independence, a very succinct document, actually. There's this language in there of the mortal danger that befell Ukraine as a result of the coup. And of course, that was partially because, you know, there were about those huge number of troops, Soviet troops, on Ukraine's territory, in fact about some 700,000. And it wasn't quite clear at the time of the coup exactly whose orders they would follow, whether it would be the Soviet Minister of Defense, who was one of the putschists, or one of the coup perpetrators, and Ukraine's nascent Republican leadership, and in particular the Speaker of the Parliament, Kravchuk, recalled when General Varennikov, the commander of all the armed forces, so most of these 700,000 guys, walked into his office and said, "You shall listen to the orders of the extraordinary committee." And at that point, he realized that really, as a sort of head of self-proclaimed sovereign state, he only had a few 1,000 maybe of National Guard troops under his command, and the rest were troops loyal or under oath to Moscow. So the very next document after the Declaration of Independence that was passed by the Ukrainian Parliament was the resolution to subordinate all military units on Ukraine's territory to the Parliament. Of course, there wasn't an institution of presidency back then, not until December 1st when Kravchuk was elected president, December 1st, 1991. But that resubordination created somewhat touchy problems in regard to the actual strategic missile troops and also strategic aviation that was armed with nuclear weapons as well as pretty much every branch of Soviet military that had within its structure or in its armaments tactical and so-called operational tactical nuclear weapons. As you can see here, there were about 2,800, and those were in air defense troops, ground troops, the aviation for short range aviation. They were, all of the military was inundated with these weapons, right? So the question became exactly what should happen with these strategic units, and exactly how would Ukraine manage this in the short term? What was agreed upon was a status quo, was basically not to change much from the way things were in the Soviet Union. So after the formal dissolution of the Union in the Belavezha, as a result of the Belavezha Accords on December 8th, it was agreed to just keep the nuclear thing intact, right? To resubordinate it to the so-called CIS, right? So the general command of the all of the strategic troops was to be, joint under single or unified control, right? Where all of the states on the territory which these weapons were deployed would somehow consult towards their use and development of strategy, nuclear strategy. But in the meantime, Ukraine, as well as Belarus, although not Kazakhstan, committed to transfer all tactical nuclear weapons out of Ukraine by June 1992, and to dismantle strategic weapon systems by 94. So there's officially a continuation of this pre-independence stance that these really are weapons that are not sort of, we don't want to have much to do with, and the sooner we get rid of them, the better. So the actual command and control stays in Moscow. If you know the famous nuclear briefcases, the equivalent of the nuclear football that American president has, so his sort of little unit through which he can authorize a nuclear strike. Those briefcases, the chemodanchik, was in possession of Russian President Boris Yeltsin and the commander-in-chief of the joint, the so-called joint armed forces of the CIS, Commonwealth of Independent States, General Yevgeny Shaposhnikov. Meanwhile, the tensions in Ukrainian-Russian relations mounted, mostly over, in a nutshell, over Ukraine's unwillingness to stay in the strategic orbit of Moscow, and Moscow's unwillingness to accept that as a new fact on the ground. So Moscow was irked to know, and by Ukraine's proactive efforts to establish its own military, to administer Ukrainian oath, military oath to its troops. There were, of course, tensions, and it was a very complicated situation. People had to determine their loyalty. It used to be one army, and you had to somehow, in a civilized way, to parcel it out, So some mixed loyalties and overlapping chains of command resulted in a number of incidents, one of which was basically hijacking of six long-range Su-24 bombers. They're in theory dual use, but these particular ones were not equipped with nuclear weapons or anything. They were flown out under pretext to Belarus for refueling. They ended up in Russia and never returned, and which was even more painful to the military people. They took the flag. They took the flag of the division with them. And that, for, you know, the military folk, that was a very significant thing. Of course, Crimea had always been the Achilles heel of Ukraine's territorial and territorial integrity and political kind of stability and independence. And, you know, it was the base, is the base of the previously Soviet and now Russian, but previously Russian Imperial Black Sea Fleet. Ukraine's, there were quite a few officers within the Black Sea Fleet who desired and wished to take Ukrainian oath, military oath. In February 1992, there was an incident when Ukraine's, a delegation of Ukrainian from Ukrainian parliament and from Kiev arrived at the headquarters in Sevastopol of the Black Sea Fleet. And requested to, you know, talk to Admiral Kasatonov, who was the commander of the Black Sea Fleet at the time, very loyal to Russia, and simply to inform them of this, you know, establishment of Ukrainian Navy, and there's this new oath, and whoever perhaps wanted to take it could. This delegation was kept at the gate for 2 hours and not admitted to the base of the Black Sea Fleet, which was kind of a slap in the face. It was quite humiliating. So all of throughout February and March of 1992, all of these incidents connected with kind of the disintegration or dismembering, as it were, of the single Soviet military had made themselves known. And it manifested itself in the tensions regarding nuclear weapons. For starters, in March 1992, Kravchuk, the president, announced that tactical nuclear weapons that were being transferred from Ukraine's territory will be held for a time until Ukraine can ensure and inspect that these weapons are being dismantled and not just held and then reused, right? It seems that that was only partially the reason, and all these kind of other tensions regarding the fleet and other military units and intervention of General Shaposhnikov, the commander-in-chief of the CIS forces, impeding the establishment of Ukraine's independent armed forces, had been also behind this. The Rada supports the move, and in a resolution for the first time establishes, basically claims that the strategic nuclear weapons now are Ukraine's property, and that it wants to establish, or it moves to establish, administrative control over these weapons, right? It requires the strategic rocket forces on Ukraine's territory to take Ukrainian oath, and demands the establishment of a mechanism over non-use of these ICBMs from Ukraine's territory. For the first time in this resolution, the Rada demands security guarantees and financial compensation. So this is where the question of security guarantees first makes its appearance. Concomitantly, Ukrainian Foreign Ministry is quite active in arguing that Ukraine should be included as an equal party to the Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty that had been signed between the Soviet Union and the United States just literally weeks, days before the Soviet Union disintegrated, leaving the treaty unratified. So the question was, well, who should now ratify it? Who are the successors in relation to this treaty? Of course, you know, Russia wanted to preserve the bilateral nature of the treaty and act as proxy for all these other states, which there were three, right? So there were four Soviet successors, Russia, Ukraine, Belarus, and Kazakhstan, that had assets, that is, weapons, associated with this treaty on their territory. And Ukrainians, but also Kazakhstanis and Belarusians made a stance and said, well, no, you know, these weapons are our territory, we're successor states to the Soviet Union, we should be included in deliberating and deciding matters in regard to this treaty. And they were, via the signature of the so-called Lisbon Protocol in May 1992, which recognized all four post-Soviet states as equal successor states to the Soviet Union in relation to the treaty, sort of giving these the three non-Russian republics a seat at the arms control table, as a matter of fact. However, what the Lisbon Protocol gave with one hand, this recognition, it took away with the other hand. In Article 5 of the Lisbon Protocol, the three non-Russian Soviet successors, so Ukraine, Belarus, and Kazakhstan, committed to join the NPT, the Non-Proliferation Treaty, as non-nuclear weapon states in the shortest possible time. So there was an understanding that even though they're successors to START Treaty, they still are expected to disarm, right? By the end of 1992, there's increasing talk of what turns out to be, or what is termed, nuclear ownership in Ukraine's political discourse when it comes to it. And there's also some talk, in particular by, you know, some people in the Rada, in the parliament, and some military folk, about keeping the 46 SS-24s. So kind of interpreting Ukraine's obligations under START, under the reduction treaty, as exactly that. Reducing, right? START is not a total disarmament treaty, right? It's not a full elimination treaty. So reduce nuclear armaments in Ukraine's territory in accordance to START, and then think about the rest. So what is nuclear ownership, right? There isn't really such a category. We know about nuclear possessors, nuclear weapon states. What exactly did Ukrainians mean under nuclear ownership? In response to sort of the mounting pressures and demarches from different embassies and negative international press, in December 1992, the Ukrainian Foreign Ministry distributes this memorandum that tries to explain Ukraine's position on nuclear weapons. And they say that at the time of Soviet dissolution, Ukraine, as a successor state of the Soviet Union, had undeniable equal right to become a nuclear weapons state, right? There was one nuclear superpower, it fell apart. Ukraine is a successor to that nuclear superpower just as much as Russia is. However, because of its own internal motivations and reasons, it unilaterally and willingly chose not to do so. Hence the Declaration of Sovereignty and other documents passed by the Rada that reaffirmed that that commitment. However, all these strategic weapon systems and nuclear warheads associated with them, right, because by this time all the tactical nuclear weapons are withdrawn, are the rightful property of Ukraine. Good. What does that mean? What does that mean in relation to nuclear weapons, right? Of course, you know, any such claims were interpreted by Russia as Ukraine's bid to backtrack on its commitments to denuclearize and to become a nuclear weapons state, right? And they do promote this narrative through media, but also through their communications with the U.S. counterparts. In the United States, there are different takes on it, right? The United States government is not quite sure, it seems. What they know that is that their interest and their long-standing interest of the United States government is non-proliferation. What they know is that they will do everything they could and design policies in such way to whatever Ukraine's claims are, that Ukraine should disarm at the end of the day, and that there should be no new nuclear weapon state as a result of the Soviet collapse. The U.S. academia, drawing on these kind of deterrence theories that we had discussed just a few slides back, says, well, hell yeah, you know, there is a new country that is being threatened. It borders a conventionally superior state and a potential adversary. Of course it should want to retain a nuclear deterrent. It makes every sense. And in fact, you know, the dawn of international relation as a discipline here in the United States, John Mearsheimer of the University of Chicago publishes this famous article in Foreign Affairs saying not only that Ukraine should, but that it would retain these nuclear weapons because it makes every sense based on these, you know, U.S. Theories of nuclear deterrence and strategy and such. So I will make a bit of a kind of awkward jump now in this talk to address kind of to zoom out and address a more, let's say, technical side of the issue. It is often said that Ukraine did not keep nuclear weapons because these weren't Ukrainian nuclear weapons to keep, or that it basically couldn't establish operational command and control over these weapons. So sort of the question here is sort of moot, right? This is a negotiating ploy by Ukraine, talking about this, the different ownership. So what I endeavored to do is to actually unpick exactly what Ukraine had and exactly what technological capacities it possessed in relation to these nuclear weapons. So it had 176 intercontinental ballistic missiles. 130 of those were not produced in Ukraine, although guidance systems to them were produced in Kharkiv, were designed in Kharkiv and produced in Kyiv, in Kharkiv by Khartrom, Ukrainian defense enterprise. They were the older missile, and in fact, there was already in process, there was a process already underway of replacing these older SS-19s with the newer and more, you know, more powerful, as it were, SS-24s that were produced in Ukraine, although the guidance systems to those were not produced in Ukraine, and just how the Soviet defense industry and other kinds of industries operated. So, as I said, the launch authority for those still at the time rested with the Russian president and the CIS commander-in-chief. So this is the SS-24. It's now at Pervomaysk. At Dnipro, you can see it. At Yuzhmash, the missile producer. So this is just one, this is a map of five, of one division, the 46th Strategic Missile Division in Pervomaysk, that had under its command 40 SS-19s and 46, I believe, SS-24s, right? So if you see here, these little dots, those are missile silos. For each 10 or so, there was a command, launch command center, and then all of them were connected back into the main sort of the division command center in Pervomaysk. These are a bit schematical, but this is from the Museum of Strategic Rocket Forces, now in Pervomaysk. Here you can see a model of the SS-24, how it sat in silo. It was from, you know, tons and tons of reinforced concrete with the big lid on top of it. They were designed to be quite survivable, that is to survive a nuclear strike. And for every 10 of those, that would be a launch command center, also sort of set in a silo. And here on the 11th level down, take an elevator down. You can actually go to a museum now and take an elevator down to one of those. They preserved it. There was a launch command center that had two of these units, right? So to launch a missile, you needed, you know, after you put in the right codes from that came in from Moscow, right, from the higher ups, you had to press this button and turn a key in this little part here within 2 seconds of each other. So press a key and turn, press a button, turn a key. And then another person, so there's a dual, dual two-person rule, right? Another person had to do the same within 5 seconds. If you fail to carry that out with that precision, then the missiles wouldn't launch. Right. So there's 130 of those, 176 of those guys in Ukraine. Then there were heavy bombers and the so-called LCAMs in U.S. military speak. That is air launch cruise missiles. So the 19-2-160s, the Blackjacks, there were the newest aircraft in the Soviet arsenal. There were probably only a couple in Russia as a test aircraft. The first kind of bunch of those were deployed to Ukraine. And there were the old 295 Bears as well. I don't have a picture of them here. And this is a cruise missile, right? It has a handsome yield of 200 kilotons. That's about 10 Hiroshimas for one missile. And there were, the precise numbers are still difficult to obtain, but there were about 700 of these nuclear-armed cruise missiles. There were also a whole bunch of conventionally armed cruise missiles. But in addition to the actual weaponry, there were quite a bit that Ukraine inherited in terms of defense industry, in terms of all the sort of the back office that delivers this this nuclear might. Ukraine was viewed as a very reliable republic, Ukraine and Belarus, and no expense was spared toward the development and the building up of large missile military industrial enterprises in Ukraine's territory. And of course, the most prominent of those was Yuzhmash, or Pivdenmash in Ukrainian. It was both a design bureau, one of the three main design bureaus that worked, that designed Soviet ICBMs, and the actual two missile factories, one in Pavlograd and one in Dnipro, the Yuzhnye. They produced rocket engines. There's only about seven countries in the world that manufacture rocket engines and missile engines. They produce solid missile fuel, which is a more advanced kind of fuel to the liquid missile fuel. Kharkiv was another big node in Soviet defense, military defense complex. It had Khartron, which I mentioned, that designed guidance and targeting systems for ICBMs. The enterprises in Kiev produced whatever, one was Elektro-Kiev, Elektro-Pribor, that produced whatever Khartron designed. Monolith designed these things, so kind of the control panels. That was also in Kharkiv. So all said and done, there was quite a large capacity in terms of scientific knowledge and the actual technical know-how to establish operational control over the weapon systems that were deployed in Ukraine, in particular the ICBMs. And that was confirmed by through my interviews with the former retired military personnel and the rocket forces guys that commanded these units. They said that would not have been a difficult thing to do, given the capacities and expertise that existed in Ukraine at the time. However, nuclear weapons are not only missiles, they're also nuclear weapons, right? The actual nuclear warheads had to be produced and maintained. And in terms of nuclear fuel, sort of the nuclear fuel cycle, there were also, you know, some of the things that Ukraine had. First of all, there were four nuclear power plants with about 15 reactors, civilian reactors, of course. But, you know, I don't want to get too technical in regard to this, but once you have a nuclear civilian industry, it's already a first step towards kind of your nuclear expertise and also nuclear fuel cycle. For instance, the two RBMK reactors that still continue to operate at Chernobyl, they were particularly good, quote unquote, to generating plutonium as a byproduct of a nuclear reaction. So you would have needed a plutonium reprocessing plant to extract that plutonium out of the spent fuel, right? There were three research reactors in the institutes in Kyiv, Kharkiv, and Sevastopol. Ukraine mined its own uranium ore and milled it, made it into the so-called yellow cake, which is the first part in the processing, in the fuel cycle process. And it already had quite a quantity of highly enriched uranium. So HEU stands for highly enriched uranium. What it didn't have is indigenous, is a full fuel cycle, right? So to get fissile materials, and this is very confusing, but whoever is familiar with things nuclear will find this kind of, that this makes sense. So to produce a nuclear weapon, you need quite a few things on the ground, quite a few industrial things. This is what Ukraine had of the full nuclear fuel cycle, fuel fabrication, and warhead production. Right? The rest of it was in Russia or elsewhere. So there was mining and milling, but then you need to process it, make it, basically make your ore, your uranium ore, transfer it into a gas. UF6, uranium fluoride, hexafluoride. Then you have to spin it through centrifuges, enrich it. Then you have to turn it back into metal and fabricate what they call a pit. That is the highly enriched uranium thing that goes inside a nuclear weapon and that is responsible for this huge nuclear reaction, right? That goes into assembly and goes into a warhead. Alternatively, you know, your enrichment also works to produce fuel for your civilian power plants, right? If you do low-enriched uranium, that could go into your reactor, right? None of that existed in Ukraine. This is your civilian reactor. There is byproduct of it spent fuel. From there, you can extract plutonium, which is another fissile material from which your pit could be made, right? So, in terms of obtaining the actual fissile material for a nuclear weapon, there were a lot of pieces that were missing. Here's how the pit looks. That's what's inside a nuclear bomb, right? And that's how a nuclear bomb looks, right? It's not, this is a thermonuclear bomb, that's what goes on top of your ICBM. It's more complicated and a lot more involved than a regular nuclear weapon, the kind that was dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, right? So there's a lot of engineering. They're very complicated things, and it's not easy to make. However, in the assessment of a bunch of Russian scientists from one of the Russian nuclear labs, Всероссийский научно-исследовательский институт автоматики, which is the equivalent of Sandia labs here. As you know, there are three main labs in the US, and there were three main labs in the Soviet Union. In their assessment, Ukraine had a lot already there that with some development and investment could yield a nuclear deterrent. So to start with, here's nuclear material. It's a little busy, so Ukraine is, as you see, highlighted in red. And it's, you know, all you need to see is that there are quite a bit of pluses around. And that means that even if it doesn't exist already, it requires just a minor development effort. So electronic components and explosives, conventional explosives, the same for measuring equipment, cadre, the know-how, the scientists, delivery systems were already there, both ballistic and tactical, bombers. There is an Antonov plant, a big aircraft maker. All right, so that's almost there. And of course, there's access to information which the scientists could make use of. So there's quite a few pluses around. So in short, technologically, on the supply side of things, short term, Ukraine could have rather easily established operational control over the ICBMs and ALCAMs that it had. The Western assessments were between 12 and 18 months. Bruce Blair, a specialist and, you know, a former missileer himself, and the specialist said that the initial direct costs for Ukraine would be quite small. The problem was long term. So closing the gaps in the nuclear fuel cycle would have taken quite a bit of investment, right? Warhead production was something altogether new that would have had to be established. There would also need to be the adjustment of the strategic arsenal for Ukraine's needs, deterrence needs, because the ranges on these ICBMs, on these missiles, were too long to deter Russia, for instance. So you could only target places out behind, beyond Urals with a 10,000 kilometer range, whereas for an effective deterrent, you have to be able to target Moscow, St. Petersburg, at the very least, right? So, of course, economic costs would played a role. Plus, Ukraine really did not have the benefit of secrecy, right? A lot of states developed their nuclear programs clandestinely, right, in these small sort of closed programs. And then they, announce and break out. Ukraine was quite transparent. So whatever, in the early 90s in particular, whatever would have been undertaken would have been very visible, of course, to Russia, but also probably to the United States as well. So these were the challenges. Despite these challenges, there were some initial explorations. So early on in April of 92, there was a meeting of Ukraine's Defense Council, which was the first sort of high-level nuclear discussion. And there was the strategy proposed to delay the dismantlement of at least the SS-24s, right? And later on, the National Space Agency of Ukraine, a body closely associated with Yuzhmash and the Yuzhny Design Bureau, had actually conducted a feasibility study. They looked at what it would cost to build up enrichment and reprocessing, ENR, here, to build new control and guidance systems for the SS-24s produced in Ukraine, what it would take to build a warhead production. So they concluded that it would be costly, that international reaction would be severe, and then there was also a general lack of political will, which brings us to the demand side of Ukraine's nuclear discussion, the political motivation. Why was there a lack of political will, right? So in terms of what ownership was actually meant versus how it was interpreted by US and Russia, there were several different takes, right, on what this nuclear ownership spelled and how to use it in political, as a sort of in Ukraine's interest. One was the position of President Kravchuk in the foreign ministry. Their demand for sort of recognition of this ownership was really based on trying to get a fair compensation for giving up nuclear weapons in terms of security guarantees and in terms of financial compensation for the fissile material, uranium and plutonium contained in the warheads. None of these people really thought of Ukraine's weapons in military strategic terms, right? Only in sort of international political terms. And there was a concerted effort on the part of Ukrainian's foreign ministry, but also President Kravchuk, who represented Ukraine internationally, to make sure Ukraine joins the international community on good terms, to make sure that coming out of sort of this totalitarian empire, it is now an aspiring democracy and it is recognized as such, and it is received in the community of nations as sort of this good international citizen, which meant necessarily joining the non-proliferation regime and not making, you know, a scandal out of nuclear weapons, as it were. But in terms of deterrence, in terms of kind of thinking about nuclear weapons, there were very few quotes that you could find, very few few references by President Kravchuk. But there's this one in his interview to, I think, Elsevier, a technology publisher, that where he discussed that even, you know, if these missiles were armed with conventional warheads, all you need to do is target a nuclear weapon, a nuclear power plant, and what will happen? And you can see sort of the ghost of Chernobyl is haunting still this thinking. And in real terms, all of us could be obliterated without nuclear arms because there are nuclear power stations, Chernobyl. I think all nuclear weapons must be destroyed. So for a person thinking in deterrence terms, being able to target and what they call hold at risk a strategically important object, such as a nuclear power plant, actually means you've got something, right? That is what deterrence is all about, is about being targeting valuable targets and holding them at risk. For President Kravchuk, that was not acceptable. He kind of balked at the idea of having to target anything and being the commander-in-chief that would have to deliver upon it. So he sort of doubted his own credibility of making such a threat. And to be honest, you know, you wonder, you know, which position is more sane, right? There was another position or take on nuclear ownership. And that was from a faction within Ukraine's parliament, the Rada, that was led by Yuri Kostenko in particular. And they took this Kravchuk's position, a position of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, as overly defeatist. They said, we have to make more out of this. And we don't have to argue that we are a nuclear state. We are a nuclear state, you know, that we are a successor state to the Soviet Union. These weapons are rightfully ours. We will ratify START, but hold on the NPT, and we'll retain these 46 SS-24s. However, even people in Kostenko's camp, they again balked at looking at this inheritance, this capability, in military strategic terms, right? Dmytro Pavlichko, he was the chairman of the Parliamentary Committee on Foreign Relations, I believe, at the time. He said, you know, this was his position exactly, but he said, of course, we do not look at these weapons in military terms. You know, we will never think of threatening or using them against anybody else. And then Yuri Kostenko produces this very curious quote on nuclear deterrence, saying that even if these weapons are under the control of a different power, they still have a deterrent effect. And one might think, well, how? If you don't control these weapons. So it seems what he might have meant was that, in a sense, just having physically these weapons in Ukraine's territory would draw attention of the powers to Ukraine, would keep this focus on Ukraine. And if there is any kind of intervention from the Russian side, Americans would come in and do something, like they wouldn't let Yugoslavia unravel, you know, into a civil war. If there were nuclear weapons there, they would kind of intervene quicker. So perhaps something along those lines. There was, however, but one person who openly talked about Ukraine's endowment or inheritance in deterrence terms, and it was a former commander of that 46th Strategic Missile Division, Volodymyr Tulubko. He came from a prominent military family. His uncle was the commander of all Soviet rocket forces at one time. And he openly, he was, at that time, he retired from the military. He was a deputy in the Rada. And he said, our renunciation was premature. Nobody takes a non-nuclear state seriously. We have this, you know, incredible capacity. let's keep it. Let's keep the 46 SS-24s. Let's not, you know, accede to the NPT, and then we'll think about it. However, if you read his kind of position closely, and now there's actually quite a few documents translated into English and are online. I'll talk about this later in a bit, where, you know, his position paper on this is translated and available. If you read this closely, he really saw this as a joint Ukrainian-Russian operation. He recognized that, you know, maintaining such an arsenal would be unfeasible for Ukraine alone due to economics, but also other reasons. So, you know, cooperating with Russia would be the only way to go, kind of this joint deterrent. He also wasn't quite sure exactly whom Ukraine would be deterring with these deterrent weapons. And he did mention, you know, you can see some of the leftovers of the old Soviet military thinking that was not reformulated for Ukraine's new strategic realities. So he said, you know, no architects of the New World Order, you know, replaced this with the United States, could, you know, boss us around, basically, like they did with Yugoslavia and Iraq. Needless to say, this position was really quite marginal in Ukraine's nuclear discourse. However, there was yet another, and I'm closing, I'm finishing very soon. There was another quite underestimated, I would think, I would say, position in the nuclear discourse that I'm beginning to kind of dig a little bit more in more depth with. And that is a position of the missile lobby, the defense industry. They were not quiet. They saw that come January 1st, 1992, Moscow severed all the procurement contracts from Yuzhmash. They had nothing to produce. A factory, the world's largest missile factory that employed at one time 60 or 70,000 people, was looking basically at its own demise, and they weren't going to take it lying down. So their vital interest to keep their production lines going concerned primarily the missile production, right? So nuclear warheads were a thing that did not concern them very much. So they engineered this sort of stance where they thought of keeping the 46 SS-24s that they themselves produced and re-equipping them with conventional warheads. And this was quite seriously considered, is my understanding. Of course, those would have to be a much higher precision, and there are all sorts of military strategic calculations as to why. But the most important thing is that when you keep these 46 missiles, you also keep the 46 silos and the launch control infrastructure. That is quite valuable. So that means that when the missile is, you know, even if it's not, if it's too long range, even if it's not useful for deterring Russia now, a different missile could be designed and produced and retrofitted into those silos with that launch control infrastructure that could serve Ukraine's strategic needs better. However, Ukraine, as a successor state of the Soviet Union, was also a successor to the Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty, the so-called INF, that is now deemed to be quite dead because Trump administration announced that it might be pulling out of it. And that particular treaty prohibited missiles with the ranges from 500 to 5,000 kilometers. So even if this option were successful, Ukraine would run into US and international community and everyone else with the INF, meaning that the ranges that were useful for Ukraine's conventional deterrence or any kind of deterrence were prohibited at the time. So U.S. understood that quite quickly, turned around and offered as a carrot, as it were, a membership in a full membership in missile technology control regime, which is a regime that manages missile production, right? Agreed that Ukraine should join as a missile producing and a space firing nation, which was, you know, a separate negotiation in and of itself. So at the end of the day, Yuzhmash and the people who represented its interests at the National Space Agency basically agreed to this deal as a only way to save Ukraine's space industry from complete demise. So why? Why is there such a dearth of deterrence thinking in Ukraine? Well, for starters, the very concept itself is paradoxical, and one might not be surprised that, you know, faced with the expectation to threaten the very thing that you are trying to prevent, might seem perplexing. These leaders were not party to these kind of deterrence type of relationships and discussions, and it would have taken some time to educate them. Who would educate them? A lot of defense intellectuals, so-called people that go between military and political leaders, kind of translate military speak into make it accessible for political leaders, were left in Moscow. There are very few in Ukraine, right? And the possible actor, the actors that could have possibly pushed that kind of agenda were occupied with something else. So the military and the Ukrainian Ministry of Defense, in particular Minister Konstantin Morozov, they had their hands full with conventional military. They had this huge army, unwieldy, that they needed to somehow reform and readjust for Ukrainian, for new Ukrainian state, right? The missile lobby focused on missiles, and the civilian nuclear industry that could have become an important actor, like say it did in France and in India, they were just coming out of this kind of defense industry secrecy, where parts of these enterprises were very much restricted, where people, there were whole cities in the Soviet Union that does not exist on the map. They were only known by their postbox, by their index. And they did not want to be trapped again in this kind of secret establishment. They wanted civilian cooperation. They wanted international contacts. So with that, and with the dearth of deterrence thinking, it was really the first two positions between President Kravchuk and between Rada that prevailed in Ukraine's political discourse. So there was still an attempt to keep the 46 SS-24s, but really as political tools and as negotiating tools. And with this, this is the explanation basically for conditional ratification of START, where Ukraine decoupled its commitment to join the NPT from its commitment to reduce nuclear weapons or complete its obligations under START, and decided to interpret its obligations only as reduction, right? Not full elimination, conditioning full elimination on further security guarantees. Neither the US or Russia elected one bit. There was active US diplomacy that resulted in a trilateral statement signed in Moscow in January 1994, and that was basically the crux of the nuclear deal. So Ukraine got compensation for the fissile material. Those were kind of secret side notes that Russia didn't want to have out in the public domain. There was an agreement that the fissile material, the highly enriched uranium plutonium that's extracted from these warheads, there were accounting rules agreed, would come back to Ukraine in the form of nuclear fuel for nuclear weapon, nuclear power plants. And the guarantees, or rather assurances, part of this deal became basically the basis for the Budapest Memorandum. So even though Ukraine still sort of insisted a year later, when it was voting on the accession to the NPT, that it was unique in respect to this treaty and the nuclear weapons were still its rightful property, it nevertheless acceded to the NPT and signed the Budapest Memorandum on December 5th, 1994, as we can see. Concluding thoughts. Having it doesn't mean you know how to use it or you will be willing to use it, right? Technology still needs interpretation. It still needs to be put into political context and made sense of, right? So Ukraine had a generous starter package for a nuclear deterrent. It did not act on it. The demand side, the political motivations could be quite more complicated, right? The political leaders need to be taught how to think about nuclear weapons, right? And it's not it's not determined somehow by the technological nature of nuclear weapons. And with that, I'd just like to conclude that some of this research is in the working paper that's been published by the Wilson Center. They have this Nuclear Proliferation International History Project. That comes with a package of translated archival documents from Ukraine's archives. If you are interested, please Google it. And thank you so much.
Thank you, especially for, without shortchanging.